Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 1416 in the name of Sandis Gulhani on legal right to recovery. Again, I invite members who wish to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Dr. Gulhani to speak to and move the motion. 7 minutes, please, Dr. Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The ongoing failure of successive SNP administrations to tackle a spiralling drug addiction epidemic that's ruining countless lives is a national scandal. There were 1,339 drug deaths in Scotland in 2020, an increase of 5% from 2019. And since 2007, drug-related deaths have almost tripled, while Scotland's drug death rate is over 3.5 times that of the UK as a whole, and it's higher than any other European country. People in our most socially deprived communities are 18 times as likely to die from drug-related deaths than those from affluent areas. These are stats, but every death is a person and a family's world that's turned upside down. And given these stark facts, after 2 decades of devolved government and 14 years of an SNP administration, I can't help but conclude that this Parliament hasn't yet grasped what drug addiction means, or else we'd have solutions by now. We sit in this iconic Parliament, once described as a tour de force of arts and crafts and quality without parallel in the last 100 years of British architecture. And we're far, far removed from the lives of addicts in our communities that we have a duty to help. When I listen to proposed solutions to our country's shameful record on drugs, all I hear are aspirations based on a version of life success that means little to those outside these walls who are struggling with addiction. As a Glasgow GP, let me tell you what success means to those Scots, our fellow Scots, who are living on the edge. Success is not simply stop taking drugs. Success is simply just waking up. Success is not breaking the law to buy drugs. Success is going through the day without being abused. One of my patients, let's call her Rose, started smoking as a young teenager before being offered cannabis. She got in with the wrong crowd, around 13 or 14, and then started taking cocaine and eventually heroin. What made Rose change track was an utter tragedy. She watched her best friend overdose and die in front of her. She knew she was next unless she changed. She knew she couldn't do this anymore and survive. She needed help, and she had the courage to ask for it. And Rose was lucky, because help was there at Hunter Street Health Centre in Glasgow's Gallagate. The centre brings together many of Glasgow's homeless health and social care services under one roof alongside a dedicated GP service. She is now off drugs and holds down a job in Glasgow. Rose got there because of the all-around support that was in place. Rather than decriminalise and make this a justice issue, we need to medicalise and provide joined-up approach across services that will support drug users' recovery and give them a path to a new life. Another patient of mine, let's call him Paul, once a very heavy drug user, was so overwhelmed with life that he attempted suicide. Thankfully, he has now reduced his consumption and is on the long road to recovery. This is what success looks like. Both Paul and Rose say the key to success is for the support services to be ready to grasp the opportunity when someone first says, "Help, I want to stop." This response must be quick. They need to get on a pathway as soon as possible that includes help with housing, basic care, GP services, mental health and counselling, all the elements that the Scottish Conservatives have set out in our Right to Recovery Bill. We want to guarantee that everyone in our country who needs drug treatment can receive it. This is the cornerstone of a strategy to tackle our national scandal, to turn the tide of ever-increasing drug-related deaths. We want to provide all the appropriate treatment options that our country has at its disposal so that those seeking help and their support team can have the best possible care plan. This is ambitious because most of our communities don't have a Hunter Street, but we need to do this. No ifs, no buts. Rehabilitation requires medical service-led solutions. Laws don't cure addiction. But while we sit here in our design award-winning chamber, let's have a think about not going down this route. What if we just tried decriminalisation? Now, I know the government benches will say that this is not backdoor decriminalisation, but the public perception is that this is, and that is what really counts. If we don't have a credible support and rehabilitation regime in place, well-planned and resourced, do you think those suffering in our communities are going to be okay? We wouldn't be able to cope if only 10% of all drug users said they wanted to quit tomorrow. Our fellow Scots on the edge need our help, and we need to get working on this now. Practical action is much more progressive than simply passing legislation. There's also unintended consequences of decriminalisation of Class A drugs. Drug use could actually increase among recreational drug users, like the weekend user. Not all drug users are the stereotype people think of. There are adults holding down jobs who use drugs, like cocaine, from time to time, knowing it is a criminal offence. We need to ask ourselves the question, if it is no longer illegal, are they going to stop, continue, or even start using more? Presiding officer, we are dealing with one of Parliament's most pressing and well overdue matters. We seek to consult with the government on the Lord Advocate statement of the 22nd of September. Given the importance and potential consequences of the government's mission, we feel this request is reasonable. And we have given our debate time to this, and we would like the government to do the same. We also seek a cross-party commitment to back our motion today so we can move to enshrine in law a right to recovery, a progressive medical approach to Scotland's humanitarian crisis. Let's act to rehabilitate the most vulnerable in our communities, and let's do this now. I move the motion in my name and declaration of interest in my registered interest. I'm a practicing doctor.
Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Dulhani. I now call on Angela Constance to speak to and move Amendment 1416.3. Cabinet Secretary, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I would like to welcome Sandy Gillihanny to his new role and wish Annie Wells a speedy and full recovery. It should come as no surprise that the Government cannot support the whole motion as introduced by the Conservatives today. I have consistently acknowledged that we are facing a public health emergency, and the loss of life from drug-related deaths is as heartbreaking as it is unacceptable. And I once again offer my condolences to all of those who have lost a loved one and my continuing commitment to do everything possible to turn the tide on drug-related deaths. Presiding Officer, my position is clear that this Parliament and the UK Parliament should consider any proposal that is based on evidence and can play a part in saving lives. And that includes upholding the rights of individuals to recovery or treatment, whether that be through harm reduction or recovery in communities or in residential settings. And last weekend, I spent time on the recovery walk in Perth with some absolutely amazing people who have achieved great things despite great adversity on their own journey in life. And I strongly believe that supporting the Conservative motion today would be letting down all of these people and many others, because the motion simply fails to recognise that addressing drug misuse has to be done through a public health approach. Yes.
Jamie Green.
Thank you. Which bit of our calls for a right to recovery, enshrining that right to rehabilitation treatment in law, is letting them down?
Cabinet Secretary.
I was actually talking about your hysterical reaction to the Lord Advocate's statement last week. And Mr. Green, with respect, if you had perhaps paid attention to the many comments I have made about Conservative calls on your right to recovery bill, which is interesting, it's now called a right to recovery bill as opposed to a right to treatment bill, but perhaps that will come out in debate. I have always said that once you have published the bill, and I, like others, have had the opportunity to ensure that that bill will do what it says on the tin, I will give a view about it. But I do have an open mind about whether at some point we need to legislate. Presiding Officer, the national mission that we have announced comes with an additional £250 million in funding, and it is driven by the rights people already have to respect and to healthcare and to human rights that this government is strengthening through a new framework. And the creation of a national care service will also be an opportunity to make those rights real, just as we are doing through our national mission. The work being done by the Residential Rehabilitation Development Working Group will help us increase capacity in rehab and improve services, including aftercare. The introduction of medication-assisted treatment standards will help ensure people have immediate access to a wider range of treatments in more settings, including where they are. And these practical measures will help make rights a reality. And one of the most significant changes being called for through the National Mission is to embed a public health approach, wherever appropriate, in our justice systems. However, prosecution policy, as I am sure MSPs will be well aware, is not something that the government or parliament has a role in deciding. And that is for the Lord Advocate in her capacity as an independent authority, as set out in legislation. This government does, however, welcome the change, as it is clear that people with a drug dependency must be supported and helped with their addiction. We know from other countries such as Portugal that diversion from prosecution from drug possession towards support or treatment can be an opportunity to ensure better outcomes for some of the most vulnerable people in our society. And I note from the amendments suggested by others today and from the discussions around the Lord Advocate's recent statement to Parliament that there is widespread support across this chamber for her decision and widespread support for police diversion. And for the record, Presiding Officer, if not preempted by my amendment, I am supportive of the Labour amendment with its reference to safe consumption facilities and naloxone. And I will be continuing to prioritise the use of naloxone, including by police officers. And I very recently had the opportunity to discuss with Police Scotland their continuing role in the National Naloxone Programme and sought assurances about the support and training available to our police officers. Signing off, so we launched the National Naloxone campaign last month, and this has already significantly increased demand through our third sector partners, and that is to be welcome. Signing off, sir, I am aware that the Conservatives will be shortly publishing their draft Right to Recovery Bill. I will be happy to consider that closely. As I said earlier, I've never ruled out the need for further legislation, but my focus right now, as I have set out to Parliament several times this year, will be on making rights a reality by getting more people into treatment and recovery that is right for them at the right time. And I'm focused on making sure that through MAT standards and increased capacity in residential rehabilitation over the next 5 years, that everything possible is done to reduce drug deaths. Forgive me, Presiding Officer. I genuinely hope to see something positive and practical in the proposed bill, but I will have to be satisfied that what is being proposed will not have any negative impact on existing practice and other existing rights. There are existing and crucial rights already in legislation, such as the Patient Rights Scotland Act and the Children's Scotland Act, and I am looking forward to hearing from the authors of the bill how these rights will be fully retained.
You need to conclude now, Cabinet Secretary.
And I will indeed conclude.
By moving the amendment.
By moving the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Claire Baker to speak to and move amendment 1416.2. 5 minutes, please, Ms Baker.
Okay, thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week, I welcomed the Scottish Recovery Walk to Perth within my region. And while we focus on Scotland's unacceptable high level of drug fatalities and mourn the unnecessary loss of life and loved ones this afternoon, we must also recognise the potential for recovery and the importance of investing in people and services. The grip of addiction is unrelenting and powerful. People need support services to be flexible, responsible, responsive, free of stigma and committed to the long term. The recovery walk shows that change is possible and we must do all we can to support people to make that change. We are all aware of the Scottish Government's complacent approach to drug addiction and treatment in recent years. The cuts to ADPs, which led to a contraction in services, a lack of focus on the rising deaths and a lack of urgency in responding. But as I said in the debate in June, this is the start of a new Parliament and I will work cross-party with Government and with other parties to deliver meaningful and significant change to ensure the delivery of the MAT standards and to scrutinise whether policy is making a real difference. We must be open-minded and evidence-led. We will consider the Member's Bill that the Conservatives are bringing forward. I am open-minded on its proposal to introduce a legal right to recovery, but I do think it needs scrutiny. It needs to ensure it can deliver what it sets out to achieve. The organisations who have worked with them on this bill do so out of a sense of frustration and a desire to help those looking for support. I met with Anne-Marie Ward from Favour this week. I can understand the frustration with the lack of change, with inadequate services, with a postcode lottery of care and a lack of options for people seeking treatment. We will consider whether a legal right to treatment is going to address these issues. We must think, will it deliver the funding that is needed? Do we need it as a lever to drive delivery of services? And will a meaningful right be realised? These are issues that need to be explored in detail. But the Conservatives need to recognise that while recovery and treatment options are vital and must be prioritised, and I agree that we need to see greater focus and investment, the solutions to reducing drug deaths are as reliant on harm reduction programmes as they are on rehab. Facilities that support harm reduction, whether that is consumption rooms or testing facilities or needle exchange, address the reality of drug use. It is not fatalistic to accept that some people will continue to take illegal drugs, regardless of what we say in the chamber, and the choice should not be whether to leave them in potentially life-threatening situations, such as ingesting dangerous batches of street drugs, or wait and see if they pursue recovery, if they make it that far, or continue to deal with this group of vulnerable people as criminals. I have such a short...
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful, Member, for taking the attention. But she also agree with me that part of the solution has to be prevention in terms of preventing people taking on the drugs in the first place.
Claire Baker.
That is a key point. That's something that needs to be invested in. But you can't ignore how important it is to have harm reduction policies and proposals in there that support people through this difficult addictions that they're living with. And those who support harm reduction measures, whether at safe consumption rooms or testing facilities, we're not condoning drug use. We are simply aware of the harsh realities of living with a drug addiction. And the commentary over the weekend in response to the Lord Advocate's decision from the Conservatives was disappointing and misrepresented the policy. The outrage at the last Lord Advocate's decision is, however, faux, because in 2018 they supported diversion from prosecution, and it was the Conservatives who were highlighting Durham's checkpoint diversion scheme as a model to emulate. The Lord Advocate came to this chamber as Parliament called for, and I support her decision to expand recorded police warnings, which we should be clear with her decision to make. It does not change the offence, it is still illegal, but it changes how the Crown Office and the Prosecutor Fiscal will deal with it. And police already use RPWs, and they are familiar with the judgment and professionalism that is needed to use them. In the past year, the number of diversions from prosecution has doubled. The change announced by the Lord Advocate, I hope, will increase this further. But the Scottish Government do need to deliver on their side of this equation. There has to be reliable, viable options for Police Scotland and authorities to direct people to, and all agencies must work together. I want assurances that Police Scotland are enabling the national rollout of naloxone. Social media reports at the weekend demonstrate a need for awareness raising and training for officers. The Lord Advocate has set out the role that our criminal justice services can play, but they need support from other services for this to be successful. Presiding Officer, I support the right of everyone to enter recovery services. I agree the pathways right now are not good enough, that they fail too many people, and they lack the capacity to meet the need and demand. I understand the frustration and disappointment of families who have been let down by services. I don't want to regret putting faith into the MAT standards, and that is why I will hold the Government to account on delivery, and we do need Parliament to be informed of the progress. But the charities I know working with people with addictions tell me if the standards are fully introduced, they will be transformational for people who are ready to change their lives. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I call Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I start by welcoming Sandesh Gilhani to his place? Look forward to working with him. Presiding Officer, in this House, in this chamber, we are often divided, but I've heard in the speeches made by members from all parties this afternoon so far the counterpoint of my own commitment and symmetry with my own commitment to fighting this emergency. How we go about doing that is different, as is evidenced by the amendments lodged for this debate, but we are working towards that common goal, which is to just stop people dying. On that, I would like to thank Angela Constance for reaching out several times to me and my party. I welcome that approach. But we cannot ignore there are aspects of the substantive motion that the government amendment seeks to erase. it fails, for example, to acknowledge its own failures, the government's own failures, or recognise the systematic problems that have arisen from the SNP's decision to cut funding for ADPs, alcohol and drug partnerships, by as much as 22% in the financial year of 2015-16. That sent us to the wall and severed relationships. I believe that the government have made progress on accepting responsibility for that, but I don't want to see this Parliament revise the history of how we got to this point by backing the government amendment. So after consideration, I have to inform the Minister I won't be supporting it tonight. If progress is to be made, Presiding Officer, we have to be honest about where we are and how we got here. And progress so far has been far too slow. We have the worst drug mortality rate in the entire developed world. It is nearly four times the rate of our neighbours in England and Wales. And this summer, official statistics revealed that 1,339 people died of drug-related deaths in 2020. This was an increase of 5%. It is the seventh year in a row that Scotland has reported record numbers of drug-related deaths. In December of last year, a new Minister for Drugs Policy, Angela Constance, was announced by the government to give focus and attention to this crisis. Now, I do not doubt her ability or her commitment to her charge, but we are yet to see progress on the ground that we need. 2 weeks ago, the interim statistics were released. They showed that there were 722 suspected drug deaths during the first half, the first 6 months of this year. At this rate, Presiding Officer, drug-related deaths will continue at the same terrifying rate as earlier years, and we will continue to set invidious records. Despite the focus of an entire ministerial portfolio, additional investment and interventions such as increased rollouts of naloxone, people have not stopped dying. That is why last week I wrote to the Director General of the World Health Organization asking for international help. I believe that Scotland would be well served by a WHO task force made up of leading experts in drug mortality to assess and analyse this particularly Scottish problem. Presiding Officer, the drug death crisis in Scotland needs a revolutionary strategy in order to make a meaningful difference to the way that we treat those who have suffered from drug addiction in this country and crucially to save their lives. And that starts with innovative approaches like that of Peter Crichton and Safe Consumption Rooms. And we will be supporting the Labour amendment tonight. I'm open to the idea of the right to recovery as laid out in the Scottish Conservative motion, in principle. But my concern is that it will become simply another piece of feel-good legislation. I look forward to seeing that published, and we will be scrutinising and do so with an open mind and a hand of friendship to work through that with colleagues across the chamber. But where the Conservative motion fails, Presiding Officer, is in the human aspect of the drugs crisis and in the recognition of steps that we are trying to take to lessen that impact. Liberal Democrats have had an evidence-based approach to drug policy for many years. We called for decriminalisation of drug use long before any other party, because people should not be punished for suffering. But the motion before us rails against even the smallest steps announced by the Lord Advocate last week towards that approach. We have to reduce the misery of drug abuse with compassion and health treatment. I'm just closing, I'm afraid, rather than prosecution and criminalisation, because people's lives depend on it.
Thank you. I now call Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. All members will surely welcome the opportunity to debate last week's truly seismic announcement. It's remarkable that greater discussion has taken place in newspapers and on television than in this Parliament. Who would have thought that drugs law could be so radically altered at the stroke of a pen? We keep hearing that Scotland's drug death crisis must be treated as a public health rather than a criminal justice matter. Many say the war on drugs has long been lost. There is agreement that much more needs to be done to counter the root cause of abuse and give addicts the treatment they deserve and need. It's for that reason that the Scottish Conservatives plan to bring forward a right to recovery bill, as explained by my colleague Dr. Sandesh Gulhani. The SNP government's effective decriminalisation of heroin, crack cocaine and other Class A drugs will be felt in communities across Scotland. Normalising possession of these highly dangerous substances, removing the threat of prosecution, will diminish their stigma. Sure.
Angela Constance.
Dave, I wonder if Mr Finlay would accept that the recorded police warning system has existed since 2016, and in terms of his colleague Mr Gohani's contribution about the need for treatment and support and reducing risk, would he accept that Class A drugs, such as heroin, are the highest risks presented to individuals, and therefore those are the very individuals that need our help and not our punishment?
Russell Finlay.
I think that's the very point I'm making. They need our help, they need a right to recovery. And but this is wrong-headed. Where is it? The logical inevitability of decriminalising possession, as is happening, is the increase in social acceptability, their prevalence and their use. Drug dealers will be delighted. Now, saving lives is the apparent justification for this gamble. But where is the evidence and where is the joined-up thinking? I've spent the past month badgering the Justice Secretary, Keith Brown, about the prevalence of drugs in our prisons. We know that most drugs get inside by being soaked into items of mail. Chief among them are the psychoactive substances such as etisalam. This so-called street valium causes serious medical harm to prisoners and puts staff at increased risk. Prisoners who desperately want to overcome addiction are failed by jails awash with drugs. For many of them, prisons have revolving doors. Despairing staff say that a simple and effective solution can be taken. By giving prisoners photocopies of mails and withholding the original items, you achieve a drastic reduction of drugs getting in. This happened during COVID lockdown, but the very day those restrictions ended, staff reported a significant and dramatic increase. I raised this with Mr Brown at the Criminal Justice Committee on September 1st. I raised it with him in this chamber on September 15th. Both requests were met with a vague undertaking to look into it. I raised this again with Mr Brown on September 16th. My letter to him concluded, "Given the urgency of this matter, I would appreciate immediate action, and if that is not possible, a full explanation as to why not." Now, the day after the Lord Advocate's announcement came Mr Brown's response to me. His letter appeared to have been constructed by a committee of civil servants. Here's an excerpt. "Preparatory work into exploring the implications of a change into how we conduct SPS mail processes is well underway. This work involves assessing the full impact, risk assessment, legal implications and operational requirements associated with a change in how individuals' mail is handled."
Mr Finlay, if you could begin to wind up, please.
"Appraisal has been reviewed." You get the gist. Let me put it into plain English. They could act now, but they won't. Drugs inside will remain as abundant as ever before. More prisoners will overdose. Their chances of rehabilitation remain vanishingly small.
Thank you, Mr Finlay.
I would urge members to back our motion today.
Thank you. I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you very much, President Officer. President Officer, I'd like to remind you in the Chamber that I am a board member of Moving On Inverclyde, a local addiction service. President Officer, not one MSP wants this drugs crisis to continue, and the Tories have been talking about that illegal right to recovery proposal. And quite rightly, the Cabinet Secretary has indicated today, but also on multiple occasions beforehand, that the Scottish Government will look at any proposals that come forward. That is right and proper. Asking a government to sign up to something that is not yet written isn't any way to do policy, and the Tories know that. Notwithstanding, President Officer, the Scottish Government has never ruled out the need for further legislation and will continue the detail of the and they will consider the detail of the draft right to recovery bill once it is made available. However, through their proposal, the Conservatives are asking the Scottish Government to do something, and some things actually are already happening. First of all, getting people into the treatment and recovery that is right for them at the right time is at the very core of the Scottish Government's national mission to save and improve lives. And most of the issues proposed for legislation are addressed by the recommendations of the Residential Rehabilitation Working Group that this Government has already accepted. The Scottish Government is already investing in increasing the capacity of residential rehab nationally, developing good practice on referral pathways and exploring options for standardisation and national commissioning of services. And as the Chamber knows, The Scottish Government is providing additional funding of £250 million over the next 5 years. This funding commitment emphasises the importance placed on tackling this public health emergency. There are a range of measures and investments being made, but certainly one that I particularly welcome is the moving to a five-year funding cycle for eligible third sector and grassroots organisations that are at the forefront of saving lives. This is a decision that this particular decision is something I've spoken about before in the Chamber, and as well as also when I did meet with the Minister earlier on this year. I know that this particular decision will certainly save lives across the country. Third sector organisations provide a range of services that are not always available via public services, and they can adopt a different approach also. We must empower more people to seek support, to make that support more consistent, flexible and also effective and much faster, and help services stick with the people that they support. Additional investment will also be used to support a range of community-based interventions, including primary prevention and also an expansion of residential rehabilitation. Ultimately, the guarantee of funding to third sector partners will provide the surety and also the ability for them to plan and deliver the services going forward, instead of always actually having one eye on funding bids. Friendly officer, this Parliament has heard time and time again about the need for bold actions and bold decisions to deal with the drugs death crisis. It's a national emergency, and this is something that we can all agree on. We need to be bold. We need to push ourselves into thinking about possible solutions and policies to actually help our fellow citizens, our constituents, no matter how difficult that will actually be. 33 people in Inverclyde died last year. 1,339 people died in Scotland. Whether we want to admit it or not, the war on drugs cannot be won the way we have been doing it. Now, I'm pleased with the large drug hauls that do take place across my constituency and across the country. However, that doesn't stop individuals obtaining drugs. And learning lessons from elsewhere is also something that we must do. We are failing our constituents if we don't. Presiding officer, the quote, insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting differing results, is something that this Parliament, this Chamber, has certainly begun to adopt, that we will not follow that. So to conclude with, Presiding officer, I do back the amendment in the name of the Minister, and I certainly will not be voting for the motion in front of us from the Conservatives. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Sue Webber to be followed by Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week, the SNP announced they were effectively decriminalising all Class A drugs, including heroin, meth and crack cocaine. The possession of Class A drugs is a serious offence, and this is the biggest shift in drugs policy in years, as my colleagues have spoken about today. Normally, the Scottish Government is quick to consult, and you frankly can't move for consultations. But on this, there was nothing. No debate until today, and no stakeholder involvement. Yes.
Angela Constance.
Thank you. I'm very grateful to Ms. Webber. I wonder if she is aware that 89% of people who die from a drug-related death have opiates in their system. Therefore, surely she would accept that if we can offer a recorded police warning to someone who has cannabis in their possession, is there not a bigger case to be able to offer a recorded police warning to someone who has opiates in their possession if we are serious about saving lives?
Sue Webber.
That was quite a question, given I only have 4 minutes. But although drug deaths are rising, remember the number of people convicted of drug deaths has continued to decline. Drug offences, rather, has continued to decline, so I'll carry on with my contribution. Rather than only softening the rules for drug dealers, the SNP should also focus on guaranteeing treatment for anyone who needs it. Decriminalising Class A drugs through the back door alone will only help drug dealers who are ruining our communities, and this extreme move by the SNP will do nothing to save lives. The answer to our drugs death crisis is complex, and increasing the treatment available to those who need it should be at the heart of it. Anne-Marie Ward, Chief Executive of Faces and Voices of Recovery, has said, "We have to be very clear not to view this as a silver bullet. This move will help, but ultimately it will not help people to get well on its own. It will not save lives on its own. It has to be accompanied by increasing access to treatment and rehabilitation, or nothing will change. I met with Jay Haston from the Wave Trust this week, and a former drug addict. He said that the decriminalisation of drugs will not fix the root cause of Scotland's drug deaths problem. All it does is put yet another plaster on top of an already bleeding plaster. And now everybody is having a party in the street. People from all walks of life are no longer scared to carry drugs. I visited Waverley Care on Monday, and this is what we need more of. We need more funding for third sector organisations, like Stuart McMillan has stated, who directly help people in these situations. In Glasgow, they are helping vulnerable women, often victims of domestic abuse, caught in a cycle of drug use and broader health harm. It's a person-centred service, flexible to an individual's needs, and enables people to escape the harm caused by drugs. We need more of this. I would urge everyone to back the Scottish Conservatives' Right to Recovery Bill, which will guarantee treatment or rehab for anyone who needs it. All we are asking for today is time to be set aside to debate this in full. Scotland's drug crisis is the SNP's shame. We need to see access to rehabilitation, not dangerous drug decriminalisation. Former Strathclyde Police Chief Superintendent, Tom Buchan said, "Talk about abject surrender. It should worry everyone. It shames us as a country." I support the Conservative motion by my colleague Sandesh Gulhani today. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Carol Mockin to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin by saying I think there is a general agreement now that we must treat drug deaths in Scotland as a public health issue and not a matter of law and order. I hope, somewhere in the Tory benches there is an understanding of this. For us to continue to progress and pull our country out of this spiral, we will need to maintain that understanding, and my party will support measures to do so. I'm sure my parliamentary colleagues will have noticed that there has not been a parliamentary term since Scotland re-established its parliament in 1999, that drug deaths have not been a serious concern for the constituents we are committed to represent. The seriousness with which the parliament has treated that problem, however, has only recently got anywhere near the level required to tackle it. Having seen some examples in other countries where they have worked miracles to put a stop to deaths multiplying annually, we are now slowly waking up. The Lord Advocate's recent statement is simply realistic. It's not anything the average person on the street would not understand is necessary. Drug abuse and the effects of it are not hidden away anymore. We all see it, but far too many just want to keep it at arm's length. The Lord Advocate's intervention has equally had the positive effect of keeping this issue in the headlines during a time when there has naturally been a considerable focus on other health issues. That attention is sorely required. One reform that was getting considerable attention prior to COVID, in no small part due to the great work of my party colleague Paul Sweeney, are safe consumption facilities. This is not an ideal solution, nor even one I particularly ever envisioned having to support, but over the years it had become obvious that the scale of the problem in Scotland is well beyond slogans and awareness campaigns. We need to treat this with the same seriousness we treated the pandemic, and providing safe facilities to prevent death has been proven to work. This is one example of exactly the kind of direct and meaningful approaches we need to take at all levels of health policy, policing and education. But it does require serious funding. In my own region, NHS Ayrshire and Arran are experiencing the second highest rate of drug deaths throughout Scotland. Much of that falls on the shoulders of community health workers, hospitals and indeed the police, who are overworked, underpaid and left with resources that are stretched to breaking point. Councils and health boards undoubtedly see the problem as a priority, but they simply do not have the funds to help tackle it all the time. We need to expand community resources and improve access to residential rehabilitation and treatment if we're to get on top of this. Part of that involves giving police the time and training to support any reforms taking place and not forcing through a new model with little consideration of those on the front line. The police officers I have spoken to will be relieved to hear that a more pragmatic approach is now being taken on drugs, as it frees them up to do the kind of policing that they joined the force to do. Included in this should be the proper training so that officers are prepared to respect the use of naloxone to prevent overdoses, as mentioned by the Minister. Finally, let me say, this does not have to be a debate about who can show themselves to be the toughest on people with serious addictions. If it becomes one, that is just about politics, not progress. At the heart of this issue is poverty, and whilst I fully endorse all of the measures I have mentioned already, the biggest reform we can push through to end this crisis is to remodel our economy and society so it does not have built into its architecture the acceptance that a vast number of people should simply be left to struggle in desperation while others have more wealth than could ever reasonably be required. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The loss of life in Scotland from drug-related deaths is heartbreaking and unacceptable. The Scottish Government is committed to implementing approaches that reduce drug-related harms now and in the longer term as we tackle this national mission. To do so, we need a public health approach which supports people with addictions, not an approach which criminalises large swathes of the population. We need to take bold decisions, not continue with Westminster's failed Misuse of Drugs Act. We need to consider each person as an individual and offer them the most appropriate treatment, not impose a one-size-fits-all response. Presiding Officer, the Tories are calling for a right to recovery, but in the same breath, they want to jail people caught in possession of drugs. The Tory spokesperson, in closing, could enlighten us all. Is someone with an addiction a serious offender who should go straight to jail, or a person who deserves quick and appropriate treatment from health professionals? No, you can answer that in your own time. The government amendment mentions an alternative. Portugal's public health approach, where drug use and drug-related deaths are consistently below the EU average and the proportion of prisoners sentenced for drug offences has more than halved. The Westminster war on drugs has failed. The Tories are stuck in the 1980s. We cannot arrest our way out of the drugs crisis. We need bold thinking to reduce drug deaths in Scotland, and the UK Misuse of Drugs Act needs reformed. Professor Fergus McNeill told the Criminal Justice Committee that punishment is not a smart response to problems such as substance misuse and that it rehabilitates people. Professor McNeill also... No, I would like to move on, thanks. Professor McNeill also told us that criminal justice investment should be directed to diversion at every possible turn. The Lord Advocate's statement last week is therefore very welcome. As the Lord Advocate made clear, guidelines on diversion are set by her, independent of any other person. Recorded police warnings do not represent decriminalisation. They offer a proportionate justice response in select circumstances. For example, if someone with an addiction is caught in possession of a small quantity of drugs, diversion from prosecution may be appropriate. Importantly, this will allow police more time to tackle the dealers and give drug users an opportunity to seek help. No, sorry, I want to make progress, thanks. Many new policies and initiatives have been announced and delivered by the Scottish Government in its national mission to tackle drug-related deaths. This is backed up with additional investment of £250 million over this Parliament. One of the major things that the Minister is working to implement is the medication-assisted treatment standards. The standards will ensure patients can access evidence-based, high-quality service with same-day treatment, harm reduction and support to remain in treatment for as long as requested. Presiding Officer, I will end with this. I have spoken before about the Beacons, a Lanarkshire-based recovery community. Earlier this month, peer volunteers delivered a presentation on their research project. Their conclusion was clear. The Misuse of Drugs Act 1971 is not fit for purpose, and we need a public health approach, not a criminal justice approach, if we are serious about reducing drug harm. That is the voice of experience. Let's listen to them. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Gillian Mackay to be followed by Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to extend my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one to a drugs overdose. During the debate on drug-related deaths in June, I spoke about dignity, about the dignity of people who use drugs and how they are so often robbed of this by a system which seeks to punish them for their addiction. We cannot treat this as the public health emergency it is while we continue to criminalise people. This is a health debate being led by the Tories' health spokesperson, so I very much hope that we all agree that this is a health issue, not a criminal justice one. Yet I have to admit that I do not understand some of the tone from the Conservative benches during this and some of the content of their motion. It begins by calling drug-related deaths a humanitarian crisis, but only a few lines later it calls for people found in possession of drugs to continue to be criminalised. How can we solve a humanitarian crisis which criminalises those most affected? We must abandon the failed war on drugs, which stigmatises people and actually makes it more difficult for them to access treatment and support. We need a harm reduction approach. In June, the majority of members supported my amendment, which called on the Scottish Government to investigate, as a matter of urgency, what options it has to establish legal and safe consumption rooms within the existing legal framework. Safe consumption rooms have been operating in Europe for 30 years, and there is evidence that they result in immediate improvements in hygiene and safer drug use, as well as wider health and community benefits. The Scottish Greens have long maintained that safe consumption rooms are an important public health measure which will play an important role in preventing drug-related deaths. I know that work is progressing on this issue, and I look forward to hearing updates in due course from the Minister. As the Government Amendment notes, both the Scottish and UK Parliament should consider any evidence-based proposal that can help to save lives, including a right to recovery. On the issue of rehabilitation, it is clear that residential rehab provision does need to be greatly expanded so that everyone who needs it can access it. Yes, briefly.
Sue Webber.
Thank you very much for taking my intervention. I'm just wondering, now the Member is part of the Government, can you perhaps tell us how many more residential rehab beds there will be made available this year?
Gillian Mackay.
I thank Sue Webber for my promotion, but I am not a member of the Government. To quote a Scottish Drugs Forum briefing, for people in some situations, residential rehabilitation will be vital and effective. Some people may be afraid that they will lose their tenancy if they enter rehab, or they may have caring responsibilities. It's vital that treatment services are as accessible as possible and that people who do enter rehab are protected from negative consequences such as homelessness. Follow-up discharge is vital. When people leave residential rehabilitation, they are at increased risk of overdose as their tolerance to drugs has been lowered. It's important that we recognise that people do not leave rehab cured and that they need ongoing support. Residential rehabilitation provision must be well integrated with other health and care services so that no one is left struggling to cope alone after they are discharged. We must also consider that abstinence-based recovery will not suit everyone. I've said before that we would not demand someone stop smoking before we treated them for lung cancer. There must be a range of treatment options available. Scotland only has about 40% of people in treatment at any one time, whereas England has 60%. However, many people who use drugs have been in treatment at some point in their lives, so we have significant issues around retaining people in treatment. Services must be flexible and person-centred and take account of changing needs. Community-based provisions such as drop-in cafes and peer support networks must be made available alongside residential rehab. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I will be supporting the Scottish Government's amendment because it recognises the need for a focus on harm reduction and treatment. I'm also very supportive of the content of Clare Baker's amendment, but note that it will be preempted by the Government. To tackle this crisis, we need to treat people with compassion, not judgment, and offer them support, not condemnation.
Thank you. I call Jim Fairley, last speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking the numerous organisations and individuals who gave me their time and expertise while I researched for today's debate. There are far too many of them to mention, but each contribution has been hugely helpful and equally as humbling in the work and effort they are putting in to help those affected by addiction, especially over the period of the pandemic. So why do people take drugs in the first place? That's a bit like asking what colour are cars. The reality is there is no single reason, which simply means neither is there a single silver bullet cure. In my own constituents of Perthshire, South and Kinrosshire and the wider Perth and Kinross Council area, there has been an increase in usage in drug-related drug-related deaths over the pandemic. But there is also some fabulous joined-up working through multi-agency collaborations like the Alcohol and Drug Rehabilitation Partnership, who made it clear to me that they are committed to delivering the aims of the National Drugs Mission. The scope and scale of the work they are doing is brilliant and far too big to discuss it all in a four-minute speech. But I think it's important to say that the partners in the ADP include Perth and Kinross Council Social Care Partnership, Perth and Kinross Council Children's Services, Housing, Justice Services, Local Police Scotland, Public Health, Third Sector Partners and the Scottish Prison Service. And as part of the Scottish Government's £13.5 million uplift to ADPs, this year Perth and Kinross ADP is to receive just under £400,000 and then a further £180,000 to be used in the outreach and near-fatal overdose pathways and lived living experience panels. Yes, very quickly.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the member for taking this intervention. He, I'm sure, has heard concerns from these partnerships about the proposed centralisation of them under the National Care Service. What representations has he made to ministers about that?
Jim Fairley.
Let me come to that. That's an example in my constituency of the nationwide effort that the Scottish Government are committed to. Now, I spoke to Stephen Jarden of the Scottish Recovery Consortium, who praised the £250 million funding package, with £100 million of it ring-fenced for residential rehab. And every bit as important, the aftercare and provision to ensure supported continuum so that after R&R, folk aren't just dropped back into the drug-taking environment without the necessary support. He spoke of how pleased he was to have met the Minister Angela Constance and heard her plans and her full understanding of the real lived problems, which gave him real hope that we are tackling this hellish problem with the right approach. There is undoubtedly still much to do, but when the people who have lived with and come through addiction tell me that they're optimistic about our Minister's handling of the situation, that gives me a lot of hope too. Which brings me to the Conservatives' motion. They seem to be all over the place on how to address Scotland's problem with substance abuse. In the short space of four clauses, they go from calling drugs deaths a humanitarian crisis to expressing horror at the Lord Advocate not wanting to criminalise users. Every single person I spoke to about in this issue who have lived with addiction or worked with addicts, and sometimes both, have all said the same thing. Criminalising users doesn't break the chain. I just don't see how talk of a legal right to recovery can be resolved with a determination to judge and jail users. I simply don't trust the motives held in this motion. It could be seen as cynically trying to use the death toll drugs are taking in our communities to attack the Scottish Government, while at the same time preventing and undermining many of the actions that would actually do some good. If the Tories were so concerned about the harms done by drug or alcohol misuse, why did they oppose minimum unit pricing for alcohol when alcohol was a bigger killer of Scots than what drugs was? Professor Sir Ian Gilvor, chair of the Alcohol Health Alliance, said of a recent research study by Newcastle University published in The Lancet, "This is powerful, real-world evidence of the success of minimum unit pricing as a harm reduction policy." So just as the Tories in this chamber are trying to stop minimum pricing, their colleagues in Westminster are blocking drug consumption rooms, which we know can reduce the risk of disease transmission.
Mr. Fairley, if you could wind up, please.
Yeah, absolutely. My question is this to Dr. Gilhaney: How will he maintain the trust of his patients who present to him with the disease of drug addiction when he's going to vote to jail them for an addiction that may well be attributable to poverty policies that his party have imposed in Scotland's people for decades?
Thank you, Mr. Fairley.
Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to winding up, and I call on Pauline McNeill, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. Scottish Labour are genuinely interested in the proposals for right to recovery outlined by Dr. Sandesh Gohani. Over 1,300 people died of drug misuse in Scotland last year, a record number of deaths for the seventh year in a row. As we previously discussed in this place, the highest drug death rate in any country in Europe. As Claire Baker says, Stuart McMillan says, many others, it's a national shame with tragic consequences. So it is the Scottish Government, rightly so, that are under pressure to change that. But we do need desperately fresh thinking all around this Parliament and in the process when it comes to Scotland's approach to tackling drugs. And if we don't have fresh thinking in this, we will fail. A step in the right direction is the Lord Advocate's announcement last week that confirmed that the scope of recorded police warnings has been extended to include possession only of Class A drugs. Now, I think it's important that the Tories do speak accurately about this pronouncement last week. It is still illegal to possess drugs. The law is not changing. It is not decriminalising drugs. And as well, they know it. It is a diversion from prosecution. It is important to note that the scheme applies to drug possession offences only, but it does not apply to drug supply. It is aimed at reducing drug deaths to get people on the right pathway, which Dr. Gohani talked about, I believe what he says, but to characterise this, but for the Tory benches to characterise the Lord Advocate's announcement last week as a whole-scale decriminalisation of drugs, does their proposal no justice whatsoever? I mean, has it occurred to them that a route into recovery may well be the police officer who issues a warning and under this scheme and refers that person to treatment? Has it not occurred that could actually be a pathway? It's also worth stressing that offering a recorded police warning is not mandatory, and police officers retain the ability to report cases to the Procurator Fiscal. And as the Lord Advocate noted last week, when the police encounter an individual who they know or suspect is addicted to drugs, officers are able to direct that person to the services which they may be able to assist. So surely that in itself is consistent with finding pathways to recovery. This type of referral, the Lord Advocate says, must become the norm, and we need more resources for treatment and recovery programmes urgently. I spoke in the last debate about drug consumption facilities operating in 66 countries around the world, and I think there's some agreement in the Parliament that Scotland needs to facilitate this. A review by European Monitoring Centre for Drugs and Drug Addiction concluded that there is no evidence to suggest that the availability or safer injecting facilities increases drug use or the frequency of injecting. These services facilitate rather than delay treatment entry and do not result in higher rates of local drug-related crime. I believe the Scottish Government must work within the legal framework, and I asked the Lord Advocate in her statement last week if she does consider that the supervision of those who are consuming drugs in that situation do actually contravene the 1971 Act, because it may well be that it doesn't actually contravene the Act itself if your supervision of those who are illegally consuming drugs, but in order to save lives. But I was pleased to note that the Lord Advocate said last week in response to me that she would be prepared to consider a future proposal.
Ms. McNeill,
we know,
could you wind
by the
up,
end
please?
Of March, lives were saved by Peter Kaikran, previously mentioned. It has to be a serious part of our ideas if we've not to fail in this matter.
Thank you. I call on Angela Constance. Up to 5 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Most of us in this chamber
clearly support a public health approach to our drug deaths crisis, Scotland's other public health emergency. And for most of us, the debate is how, in our national mission to save and improve lives, to reduce harm and promote recovery, how do we do everything possible to maximise that public health approach, which of course is much broader and more holistic than a purely medicalised model. And I think, like Pauline McNeill, I fear that the Tories are failing to join the dots between life-saving emergency work to improve lives, which in an all-government, all-Scotland response must include our criminal justice system, as well as our welfare system, as well as our health and education system too. And I noticed that Ms Weber said that she was worried that people would be no longer scared to carry drugs. Well, I'm worried about people being scared not to seek treatment through the risk of criminalisation. And if I can quote Dr. Joa Gualo, if I've pronounced that correctly, the architect of Portugal's reforms, when they said the biggest effect has been to allow the stigma of drug addiction to fall and to let people speak clearly and to pursue professional help without fear. Now, despite my questions about the Conservatives' proposal on a right to treatment or on a right to recovery bill, like other members in this chamber, I have been clear that I have an open mind and will give it a fair hearing, which of course is more than the Tories gave the Lord Advocate last week. And I do have to say to Mr Finlay, it's a poor show when you never let the facts get in the way of column inches in the Daily Mail or the Daily Express. Because this is the Lord Advocate's decision. It is not decriminalisation. It is not mandatory. And we heard from the Lord Advocate that it is a response that can be tailored to the needs of the alleged offence and the individual involved. So for most of us, we are trying to elevate the debate within and out with this Parliament, of course.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you. As I was saying earlier, would you encourage your Cabinet colleague Keith Brown to act immediately in relation to prison drugs and stop the mail, as I was suggesting in my speech? That would go a long way to helping vulnerable prisoners who are suffering from drug problems.
Minister.
I don't expect Mr Finlay to know this about me, but a large part of my career before I entered this place was working in three Scottish prisons and the state hospital. So I know the hard work of prison officers, both to make their institutions safe and secure. But at the same time, I also know the hard work they do to protect and promote the welfare and particularly the mental health of prisoners as well. And could I perhaps remind Mr Finlay that even prisoners these days have human rights, and human rights aren't something that we pick and choose about. So the challenges for our prison service is indeed safety and security, but is also protecting our most vulnerable citizens, some of which are wrongly placed within our prison system. Well, it's for Mr Finlay. He's a big boy now. He doesn't need his mammy to hold his hand. I'm sure he will be able to address any outstanding matters that he has with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. But of course, Presiding Officer, if we go back to the facts of the matter, if we look at the diversion scheme introduced in Baltimore, where they stopped prosecuting for low-level drug offences, out of 1,400 drug cases that they diverted, only 6 cases were involved in reoffending. If we look at Portugal, where they have 6 drug deaths per million of the population, in comparison to Scotland, where we have 315 deaths per million of the population. So we have to think big, and we have to think bold, and we have to think radical. And of course, the Conservatives are suspiciously quiet on that wide range of evidence-based interventions that work, whether it's safe consumption rooms, whether it's heroin-assisted treatment, whether it's... I don't have time, I'm so sorry, Mr Briggs, otherwise I would. And you know, we have to accept, and it's a point I think it was made by someone on the Labour benches, that this isn't about supporting harm reduction over recovery, and it's not about supporting recovery over harm reduction. It's about supporting people. And we have massive platforms of work around medication-assisted treatment.
Minister, around, if you could wind up, please.
Well, indeed, around residential rehabilitation, but we have never presented any measure as a silver bullet, but neither will we pass up any opportunity, however large or small, to take even one step forward. We will continue on our journey to save lives.
Thank you. I call on Jamie Green. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Green.
Thank you. Can I also thank members from right across the chamber for their input in today's short debate on this. For the most part, a respectful debate about our drugs crisis. And it is a crisis. Of course, there are very polarised arguments over decriminalisation or even its perception. It's not a new argument nor an easy one, and it's clear from a number of contributions today that there is agreement on the scale of the problem that we face in Scotland and even to an extent of what has gone wrong in the past and what might need to be done to fix it. But I want to be clear about why we're using opposition time today to talk specifically about the decision made by the Lord Advocate last week. It is our view that this major shift in drugs policy has not fully been thought through or consulted on, nor its potential effect or consequence fully understood or indeed debated. It is clear, and it is clear, that very little consultation took place before the decision was made. In fact, last week's announcement came as a surprise to many of us. And I'd say to Jim Fairley, who's just waxed lyrical about all the stakeholders that he's been engaging with about today's debate, that's great, but let me remind him that none of those people would have a voice in these walls had we not brought a debate to the chamber in the first place today. And I asked the government, where was the formal consultation with drug rehab charities, with the third sector, with Police Scotland, with recovering addicts? What do Police Scotland say about the new guidance or the proposed changes? What experiences do they share with you about the effect of the previous changes that were made to the possession of Class B and C drugs? And a second, what evidence is there that this approach either does work or will work? Happy to take an intervention.
Well, Mr Green, I quoted in my closing remarks evidence from Baltimore and Portugal, but you heard the Lord Advocate's statement last week. Did you not ask her these questions about her decision?
Jamie Green.
I would love to have, but we had a 20-minute question and answer session. I mean, no time. And this is the point, Presiding Officer, no time to properly debate this and listen to the voices of those stakeholders that many of us have referenced today. In fact, why didn't a Holyrood committee be afforded the opportunity to take proper evidence on this? I'm sure many of them would have been happy to do so. The Health Committee, the Criminal Justice Committee, and surely that's the role of our committees in a unicameral Parliament such as ours. And I say that because it's an important point. Let me make my point. Because just as there may be voices who support the move, there will surely be others who do not. And perhaps we ought to listen to those voices too. We argue that a shift in the guidance to police on whether or not to prosecute the possession of Class A drugs makes them no less harmful, nor will it reduce drug use or consequently drug deaths. And we are not alone in that view. Other stakeholders out there in the real world share those views. This isn't a political position. For example, the Centre for Substance Use Research said, let me finish this quote, that there is a huge risk of escalating, not reducing, our drug problem. And I want to drill down on why that argument is being made, because maintaining those legal barriers to drug use is a very powerful means by which society seeks to suppress the limitless expansion in the scale and impact of drug use. The only way to reduce our drug death total is to reduce the overall level of drug use itself. And the measure announced last week will go nowhere to do that. But why? Because the policy, as was announced, assumes the behavioural change only in those who use drugs, not those who deal in them. The dealers, who I think are buoyed by this new approach to how we police hardcore drugs. I'm happy to take an intervention.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. I raised in my speech, and I'm asking you again, why did the Conservatives in 2018 support diversion prosecution and highlighted Durham's checkpoint diversion? If you're asking for scrutiny now, you seem to be able to decide 3 years ago that you supported this kind of approach.
And I'm very happy to respond directly to that, because it is an important point. We said in 2018 that there needed to be a holistic approach. Now, I've never said publicly in anything that's been reported last week that I'm against the principle of diversion, because many ideas have been mooted over the years. Our paper in 2018 was to be commended, but it was ignored. And that is the point, because you cannot divert people from prosecution to nothing. You cannot divert them if there is nowhere to divert them to. And that is the point that we're making today. Neither can you simply point towards other countries and say, my goodness, what a great job they've done. Because you cannot do that without accepting that those governments in those countries did not make 22% year-on-year cuts to drugs and alcohol services like this government did. It's not good enough. It's not good enough simply to use emotive arguments based on the perceived benefit of a policy. We need to use facts, Scottish facts. And here are some facts for the Minister. When the SNP came to power, there were 352 residential rehab beds in Scotland. 352. There were 445 drug deaths that year. 445 too many. We all agree that. 10 years later, there were 70 rehab beds and a death rate of more than 1,000. Today, that rate stands at nearer 1,400. Minister, do you see the link here? Those are the facts. They're disgraceful ones, they're shameful ones, and they're ones that should be a source of shame on this government. In closing, Presiding Officer, one thing we do all agree on is that drug addiction destroys lives. That point was made by Sandesh Gohani powerfully in his opening remarks. Of course, these people need help, but that help is simply not there for far too many. It is our unapologetic view that the right to recovery must be enshrined in law. And let me conclude. If the government's direction of travel is, as it says, is to make our drug shame a health problem, not a justice one, fine. But ministers better make sure there's a health solution there to back it up, because their track record to date fills no one with confidence. We will support them in that journey, but they must also be willing to listen. I support the motion in Dr. Gohani's name.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on legal right to recovery and its point of order, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In this afternoon's debate on COVID vaccine passports, reference was made to the absence of the draft regulations and to an evidence base to support the policy. I understand from media reports that the Scottish Government's senior counsel, appearing this afternoon in the Court of Session, stated that the regulations would be considered by the COVID-19 Recovery Committee tomorrow morning, despite the agenda for that meeting already having been published and there being no room on our agenda to do so. Moreover, the same senior counsel produced in evidence to the Court of Session a 71-page evidence paper from the Scottish Government in support of its policy. The draft regulations and that evidence paper were then emailed to members of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee after the debate in this chamber was concluded. Presiding Officer, clearly these documents would have been very helpful in informing the debate that members were holding and presumably were ready long before the debate actually commenced. Can you investigate, Presiding Officer, why the Scottish Government made these documents available to the Court of Session but not to this Parliament, and why it is treating this chamber with contempt?
Thank you. I thank Mr. Fraser for his point of order. I'm not aware at this moment of the precise detail of the information that has been provided or the basis of which it was produced in the Court of Session. But it is, of course, extremely important that members and committees are provided with information to enable scrutiny in a timeous manner. I will review the information that has been provided, and I will return to the Chamber if I consider that a further ruling is appropriate. Point of order, John Swinney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The material that has been provided to the committee has been provided in accordance with the routine arrangements that are available and have existed throughout the pandemic for the supply of regulatory information to committees in advance of their deliberations, and that material was provided at 4 p.m. this afternoon in accordance with the normal arrangements that are in place for such arrangements.
Thank you. I thank Mr. Swinney for his point of order. I will satisfy myself as to the situation, and as I said previously, I will return to the Chamber if I consider a further ruling is appropriate. I believe Mr Kerr's point of order is next, and then I will return to Ms McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have previously raised concerns with you about the SNP Government's blatant disregard for Scotland's Parliament. This morning, the SNP snuck out government-initiated question S6W03408, which announced that the NHS would remain on emergency footing until at least March 2022. Surely, Presiding Officer, this kind of significant and substantive announcement must be brought to this chamber in the first instance, with an opportunity for members to question ministers on its consequences. We had the First Minister's COVID update statement yesterday. There was ample opportunity for the Cabinet Secretary to make a statement to Parliament in person and to answer questions. Therefore, Presiding Officer, I seek your guidance on three matters. First, you will know that on the 22nd of June, I raised a very similar point of order with you, and you said then you had, quote, asked the Scottish Government to reflect on the use of GIQs when Parliament is sitting. Do you believe, Presiding Officer, that today's events demonstrate that the Scottish Government has taken any notice whatsoever of your request? Secondly, on June 22nd, you also said that all significant, this is a quote, all significant and substantive announcements should be made to Parliament whenever that is possible. I don't think anyone can argue that this announcement is not significant and substantial. I don't think anyone can argue that it was not possible for the Cabinet Secretary to make a statement to Parliament yesterday or even today or tomorrow. Do you, Presiding Officer, still believe that what you said on June 22nd is correct? And do you share my concern that this government is disrespecting your office and this parliament by their behaviour again today? The government has already shown this week how quickly it can and does change business when it suits them. And finally, Presiding Officer, based on this approach today that we have seen from the government, I fear that the Scottish government's elusive winter NHS plan might well be snuck out over recess with minimal scrutiny, because the one thing we know about this SNP government is it cannot abide transparency or scrutiny. What, Presiding Officer, can be done to ensure that members of this Parliament will have an opportunity to scrutinise this plan before the October recess?
I thank the member for his point of order. Government-initiated questions are, of course, recognised as a mechanism through which the government can make announcements. And as I set out in June, all significant and substantial announcements should be made to this parliament wherever that is possible. There will, of course, be instances in which it is not possible to make an announcement in the chamber. In relation to question S6W03408, I have noted that the GIQ mechanism has been used both in this session and last session to confirm extensions to the period for which the NHS will remain on an emergency footing. The guidance on announcement also notes that GIQ answers can be followed up with a debate. That may be something the member wishes to raise at the next meeting of the Parliamentary Bureau, where I will visit the issue the member raises today. Thank you. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Further to the question that you will consider about scrutiny in this Parliament, particularly of the vaccine passport regulations, following a radio interview that the Cabinet Secretary for Health gave after the debate, he said that evidence to back the government's position was lodged in Spice, and I pursued this, and I was told that no such evidence existed. I asked the Presiding Officer to consider that members of this Parliament who have an interest in this debate, which I do, many others do, who are not part of the COVID committee, must have access to all of the government's advice and evidence so we can consider what position that we want to take. And it is really unsatisfactory when considering the whole basis of the government's argument around COVID vaccine passport if it's not available in our information centre.
I thank Ms McNeill for her point of order, and as I said previously, I will review the information that's been raised with me this afternoon, and I will return to the Chamber if I consider that a further ruling is appropriate. We will now move on to consideration of Business Motion 1438 in the name of George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. I call on Minister George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you. I call on Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Building on the point of order that I just raised with you, I once again rise to speak against the business programme motion. Due to the lack of opportunity for any meaningful scrutiny of today's announcement by stealth that the NHS will remain on emergency footing until at least March 2022. I understand that the announcement had to be made before the 30th of September, and what I don't understand is why it had to be snuck out through the back door on the 29th of September. And I would welcome the opportunity in meeting with the Bureau this week. I would have welcomed the opportunity in meeting with the Bureau this week or last week to discuss the appropriate way in which this announcement could be scrutinised by the Scottish Parliament. That would have been the correct way to do things. But for whatever reason, the Minister for Parliamentary Business made no mention of it at all at those meetings. Presiding Officer, we should not have to fight tooth and nail for significant government announcements to be made to Parliament. The people of Scotland are watching the tedious pattern of this SNP Scottish Government disrespecting this Parliament and its processes. The Scottish Conservatives cannot stand idly by and watch this happen. We will defend Scotland's Parliament from this overbearing executive. I urge the Minister for Parliamentary Business to bring forward a revised business motion to include a statement on today's announcement with an appropriate question and answer session. Well, they may laugh, but someone has to defend this Parliament from this executive, and we will take up that challenge. I currently have no indication from the Minister for Parliamentary Business that he intends to put such an announcement or a statement or a question and answer session into the business for next week, and that is why we will oppose the motion today.
Thank you. I call on George Adam to respond on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I feel as if I've been time-warped back to last week again, because we seem to be having the same debate on every single time the Parliament. And it's nothing to do with the Scottish Government's attitude. It's purely to do with the attitudes and the benches over to my left there. Now, when we look at this in reality, if we look at this in reality and we take away the Conservative hyperbole and we actually look at it in the reality, the National Health Service Scotland Act 1978 enables Scottish ministers to make use of direction making emergency powers to secure the continuance of services. The NHS in Scotland was initially placed into an emergency footing on the 16th of March 2020. That was in a statement by Jean Freeman, where effectively there was numerous ideas and numerous kind of ways of going forward with COVID were brought into place, and it was further extended until the end of September 2021. Whilst the number of new COVID cases appear to be in decline, health services are continuing to deal with the most challenging combination of issues. There remains a need for caution in protecting the capacity of the NHS as we move into this challenging winter period. No, I really need to get on to the end of this at the moment. There is no need There is a need, to continue with measured and consistent approach to remobilise and renewing the vital services that we all rely on. In addition, Presiding Officer, we're mindful of the impact on many frontline staff who are the most important people in this scenario, who will remain under considerable pressure and must be given the appropriate support as well as the opportunity to recover as our range of services continue to resume. So as we look through this, Presiding Officer, Jean Freeman announced to Parliament in March 2020 that the NHS was under emergency measures. Then Jean Freeman, then in March 2021, put a GIQ through Parliament, extending it at that point. In June this year, we had a situation where a letter was sent to the committee and actually made sure that everybody knew and there was debate for it, and it was continued to September now. All I am arguing here is we are living in the middle of one of the most challenging times we have ever gone through. And for the Conservatives to come here and play political games while people's lives are at stake is a damned disgrace. Presiding Officer.
Mr Adam, I would be grateful if you would address the chamber with courtesy.
Yes, I will take away the swear word there I should not have said. Presiding Officer, you may ask yourself, why is a GIQ in March acceptable? A letter in June is acceptable, but a GIQ in September is unacceptable. As I said earlier, this is about the people of Scotland dealing with this terrible situation we are currently in. It's about ensuring the staff on our NHS get that full support. And first and foremost, it's about this Parliament, the Scottish Parliament, making its decision on what business we decide as we go forward tonight.
Thank you. The question is that motion 1438 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. Therefore, we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.